Okay guys, so next topic is diffraction. Fine. Diffraction is another phenomena of wave. Fine. The first phenomena was interference, and this is the second. Diffraction. Fine. Now I'll just talk about a simple experiment to tell you how diffraction works. Okay. Suppose you have a wall over here, and this is wall. Okay. This is a light source over here. It emits light. If light is a ray, then it will just go like this. There should not be any light in this zone. Should not be any light, isn't it? But it doesn't happen like this. There is a light here. Light comes there. So actually what is happening? There's a bending of light over here. Then only light will reach there. Otherwise if you follow a straight path, light will not reach there. Right? Now, does it make, can you imagine another scenario where such thing happens with the wave? Sound. Okay? With sound, you relate to very well. Because you have never studied sound as a ray. Fine? But when I tell you that light is also a wave, and when I tell you this, you may find it a little weird. Because you have just studied light as a ray. So when I say light is a wave also, and you try to study it, okay, just like you studied sound, it will be a little weird. Fine? But then ultimately, light will behave like a wave, and whatever happens with a wave will happen with the light also. Fine? So light will bend around the edges. Okay? So write down, bending of light around the edges happens because of diffraction. Bending of light around the edges happens because of diffraction. Fine. And out. Now you can experience diffraction, like those who have specs, they can experience diffraction. As in, why you're wearing specs? So that light will bend little bit more or less, lesser than what it is bending, or more than what it is bending. So you have lens in front of you. Fine. So you can use diffraction. You can remove your specs and take a small hole like this and watch it through that. If you rotate it, there will be some angle at which you will be able to bend the light exactly the amount which your lens is bending, and you will be able to see it clearly. How much power you have?
2.5 gigawatts.
Okay, so you can watch this with your this thing, and then put it like this and try to rotate it like this and look through it. You will be able to see it clearly at some angle of light.
Only try it.
When?
Yeah, like this.
Able to see it? Right? Because light is bending. Light is bending. Okay? So there's a diffraction. Fine? And another observation in day-to-day life about diffraction is when suppose you're walking on a road, there is a night time and there's a lamp at the top, so you have a very dark, pitch dark this thing, shadow of yours, right? Around the edges you'll see never it will be sharp, it'll never be sharp. Okay, that is again because of bending of light. It will bend at different angles, and sharply it will not cover that area. Right? So diffraction is a very common phenomena. In fact, the thing that there is a limitation in our observation itself is because of diffraction, right? For example, if you are looking at a television, fine. If you look it from very close, you'll be able to see the pixels, okay? But if you are like few feet away from the television, you'll not be able to see the pixels. this is because of our limitation, our eyes limitation, and that limitation is happening because of diffraction. Okay, because of diffraction also there will be this thing, there will be fringes that we'll discuss later on. There will be dark fringes, there will be bright fringes, and central bright will be very bright and it will be very thick also. Fine. So if two images form on the central bright itself, you will not be able to distinguish between these two images. Are you getting it? And your eye itself is just small opening and the image gets formed in your retina. Diffraction happens all the time in your retina, continuously. Okay? So there's a limit up to which you can resolve two objects, or there's a limit up to which two objects will be close to each other and you will be able to see them distinctly. Fine?
This is like the car headlights, right? If it's really, really far away,
You'll see as if one.
You see one.
Yeah, something like that. Fine? So there's a limit, and this limit defines how much is a resolution of anything. Fine? So that is why electron microscope is used, because its resolution is a function of wavelength also. If you change the wavelength, you can change the resolution. So if you use electron microscope, diffraction pattern will be little less prominent. So you'll be able to resolve further. But ultimately, you'll never get infinite resolution. Fine? You'll always have to use some wave to observe an object which has some wavelength, and then that wavelength will put some limitation on the observation. This resolution also depends on size of the lens. More is the size of lens, better is the resolution. That is why telescope that looks the objects very far away will have huge size telescope. This thing, fine. So that you are able to resolve it clearly, and you may from your eye, directly if you see it from your eye, you may think that there is only one star. But if you have a better resolution and zoom in, you'll get to know that there are thousands of stars at a single location. So because of this resolution, we have some limitation with respect to our observation itself, right? So this is the importance of diffraction. All right. Now the study of diffraction can be best done by using single slit experiment. Fine. So first we'll understand how the single slit experiment is done and what all will come out based on this. I mean, what are the observations? Just like interference is best studied by using Young's double slit experiment, similarly diffraction can be best studied using single slit experiment. Okay, and our eyes are single slit. There's a small opening. Fine. So this single slit experiment which we are going to do now is very well valid to our eyes also. And every instrument you have, telescope, microscope, there will be small opening. It's like a single slit. Fine. So single slit is more common, much more widely this thing, than a double slit. Fine. So let us understand how this single slit experiment works, on what principle it works. So draw this. What? No, you have to, but the images are not getting from the same retina. One retina for this eye, other retina for that eye. Getting it? You have only one opening per retina. If not, you are a superhero. You're like, okay, two rays goes in, same retina. This is a screen. Screen is at a distance of D away. The width of the single slit is given as small a. Fine. This is the experimental setup. We are trying to see what will happen for a wave that comes from this side. Getting it? Okay. What do you think will happen? Suppose a wave comes in. Let me erase this. We'll just assume that it's right here. A wavefront comes like this. What will happen to this wavefront? This is the velocity.
becomes spherical.
It becomes central.
Hmm?
It becomes spherical.
No, you have a right.
If this opening is very large, then it will be straight. As you decrease the opening, this thing will bend and it will become spherical. You're getting it? Fine? So it will become spherical. This is just, I mean, this is the way it is behaving. Okay? Like this. It will bend. And because velocity is perpendicular to the wavefront, it will look like that. Fine? Any doubt? Now this is one way of visualizing what is happening in single slit experiment. There is another way of seeing the same thing, and that is using Huygens principle. Okay, let us see that. Again, you draw this setup. For me it is easy, I just got it. Drawn. Done. Now see, a wavefront that comes over here, when it is about to come out from here, okay, when it is about to come out from here, only this part of the wavefront will come out from here to here, right? And according to Huygens principle, every point on the wavefront will behave like a source. Fine? So it will have multiple sources, infinite sources, like this. Okay? And every source will generate a spherical wavefront, isn't it? So now you see how complicated this scenario will become. There will be so many sources, okay? They will all meet and there will be interference. So it becomes very messy. Are you getting it? So even though it is called single slit, but it is nothing but a collection of multiple interferences.
So wouldn't the same thing happen for the double slit if it is a bigger slit?
Yes, it will happen, but then we have studied it like that. Nobody till now has explained properly a difference between interference and diffraction. People are still confused. Okay? But when it comes to double slit experiment, we'll assume that each slit will emit one wave.
Only one point.
One point. Here we are considering multiple points. Because here we are trying to understand what is happening. If you consider the everything as a single wave, there is no question of interference here. Single wave will not interfere with itself. So there will not be any fringes. But in reality, there are fringes that are obtained here.
Because shouldn't this also happen in the other one?
Exactly. This should happen. Okay? Now, I have to find out where is the constructive interference happening and where is the destructive interference happening. Getting it? Suppose it happens at a distance y. Let's say, I mean, whatever I call it, constructive, destructive, it happens at a distance y. Join these two points like this. Sorry, these two points. Like that. These waves, if they are undergoing constructive interference at a distance of y, alright, tell me what is the path difference between them right now?
Perpendicular.
Ah, exactly, do it and tell me what is the path difference.
But this is A, right?
Yeah, this is A. Complete.
A sine theta.
Theta is not normal. In terms of y and d.
You can take the angle as theta to yourself.
See, spend some time. Struggle with it. If you get ready-made answer all the time, you will not learn anything. Should I tell you? Are it just like a double slit,
yeah,
as if they one slit here, one slit here.
So why A by D?
Yeah. You drop a perpendicular like this. This distance is the path difference. Okay. If this is theta, this is what A sine theta, which is nothing but A tan theta approximately. Fine. Theta is also the angle the center line makes.
How is A sine theta equal to A?
Because we are assuming y is very less. So theta will be very less. It is roughly A tan theta. And A tan theta is what? A y by d. This is the path difference. Getting it? Okay. Now, if this is equal to n lambda, what will happen? Conceptual difference? Between what and what? Between these two ways. Okay. But then are these the only two ways? There are others also. So if this path difference is lambda, does that mean the path difference between 1 and 2 is also lambda? 1 and 3 is lambda, so 1 and 2 will be lambda by 2. So these two ways are constructive interfering, but if you take these two, there is a destructive interference. You can take it? So it becomes very easy, very difficult to make sure that you take into consideration all the points. Fine? But if you don't take into consideration all the points, how will you find where everybody will constructive interfere or where everybody will destructive interfere, right? So there should be a way to take care of the fact that there are multiple ways to interfere. Fine? So I need to find out where all of them together will have destructive interference and all of them together will have constructive interference. Fine? So this is not the way to deal with this scenario. Is this clear? Right? Because right now I'm just making sure whatever happens with only these two waves. Now what if I take this wave from here and connect like this? Okay? What is the path difference between these two waves? A by 2, y by d. Isn't it? This is the path difference. Now if you, is this thing clear? Is this thing? All of you? This part difference is A by 2, Y by D. Fine? Now, if you slide it down a little bit, if I slide it down, 1 moves here, it becomes 1 dash, and 2 moves there, it suppose becomes 2 dash. What is the part difference between 1 dash and 2 dash? Will it be same? If I slide 1 and 2 like this, part difference will be same? Right? Now, look at it. 1 and 2, if you slide like this continuously, when 1 reaches 2, 2 reaches 3?
Yeah.
So are you covering entire thing?
Yeah.
I'm able to cover entire thing. And if you take 2 at a time, you can cover in this thing, all the sources together. Right? But here is one problem that, if suppose 1 and 2 are constructively interfering there, if 1 and 2 are constructive interference there, what if 2 dash will go there and create something else? Because when 1 and 2 meet there, they create something, constructive interference, right? You can't decide only 1 and 2 dash will interfere. Fine? It may happen that 1 and 2 are interfering, then 2 dash goes there and interfere with whatever happens with 1 and 2. Right? Rather than 1 dash and 2 dash together interfering, right? So there is a problem of finding where the constructive interference is happening. But here is the thing. But if destructive interference is happening, if destructive interference is happening between 1 and 2, then there is nothing to interfere there for 2 dash. Then it has to interfere with someone else. Are you getting it?
Yes.
So it is easy to track where destructive interference is happening in single slit experiment than where constructive interference is happening. And anyway, we have this knowledge that after between two destructive there will be constructive.
So you find the destructive.
So I find the destructive and in between there will be constructive. Right? So where do you think what will happen to this? What should be the path difference for the destructive difference to happen? This should be equal to n plus half times lambda. Okay? So y will become equal to write down 2n plus 1 times lambda d by a. Fine. What is this? Odd multiple of lambda d by a. Getting it? Any doubt on this? No doubt? Got it? Now why should I take a by 2? Why not I can take a by 4? I can take a by 4 also. Suppose I take 1 and 2 points, this and this. These 2 points I take and slide it like this. I can take a by 4 as well. Right? What will happen then? The path difference will be a by 4 y by d. When this become equal to n plus half lambda, what will happen? Destructive difference will happen. Right? Or y will be equal to 2 times of 2n plus 1 lambda d by a. Destructive difference. What is this? Odd multiple. What is this?
Even multiple.
So any multiple of lambda d by a, destructive difference will happen. Any doubt? Now if you take a by 8, it will come 4 times of 2n plus 1. Again even number only. Getting it? Any doubt? Okay. So y is equal to n lambda d by a. At these locations, destructive interference happens in single slit. Similar expression comes for constructive interference in double slit experiment.
So, but that's only when you can't say n, it's only when 2n plus 1 is.
So, this n and that n, they are not same.
Oh, can I just make it n?
Okay. No, it is like any integer can be represented as n. And this n will be changing from 1, 2, 3, like that. Getting it? Where do you think location of first minima will be when n is equal to? Okay, if you put n equal to 0 here, can you see that all the waves have 0 path difference? Are you getting it? So here will be maxima, no question about it. This is the maxima. Okay, so n cannot be 0. N will start from 1. And we'll start from 1. So the first minima will be plus minus lambda d by a. Getting it? Plus minus lambda d by a is the first minima. One will be up and one will be below. Any doubt?
So what shape will be? Will it just be bands extensions?
It will be, yeah. So depends on what is the shape of the slit actually. If it is circular, you will get circular bands like this.
It will be concentric circles.
Concentric circles.
It will be
yeah.
Bright and then the second will
it
be
It will be
dark
like this. This is bright, dark, then again bright,
okay.
Dark, like this. Depending on what is the shape of the slit, that will define the symmetry, right? Okay, so this is the location of first minima, which will be at lambda d by a and minus lambda d by a. What was the location of first minima in Young's double slit experiment? Y is equal to lambda d by 2d. Look at the formula. Fine. Plus minus this. So what is the distance between the first minimas, one above and one below? That will be lambda d by d. This is the distance, which is equal to fringe width. Here what is the distance between two minimas? 2 lambda d by a. 2 lambda d by a. Fine. So the central bright is having thickness of 2 lambda d by a, which is little weird. Fine. Central bright fringe has thickness more than the regular fringe widths. fine. So in single slit experiment, the central bright, first of all, its intensity is very high, and second, its width is also substantial. Fine. If you draw intensity graph here, the central bright will have highest intensity and then very low intensity as you move. Okay. And out. Right. So this is destructive interference. For constructive interference, what will happen? In between. So y will be equal to n plus half lambda d by a. This is the location where constructive interference will happen.
Right?
And out?
That's okay. This is
for? Constructive. This is destructive. For a single slit, the situation is actually reversed. Now write down comparison between diffraction and interference. Comparison. I am not differentiating them. I am comparing them. Nobody till now has successfully differentiated between interference and diffraction. So we are just trying to put some facts over here. Write down. First point, interference pattern is what? It has a number of equally spaced, interference pattern has a number of equally spaced bright and dark bands. Interference pattern, fine? That double slit experiment, okay? The diffraction pattern has central bright maximum. The diffraction pattern has a central bright maximum which is twice as wide as other maximums. Getting this? Central bright maxima is twice as wide as other maxima in diffraction. Getting it? Okay. Not only that, intensity falls as you go successive maxima away from the center, either side, in single slit. In double slit, intensity remains more or less similar. Next point. How you obtain interference pattern? By superposing two waves. Fine. Interference pattern is obtained by superposing two waves. Obtained from two narrow slits. Interference pattern can be obtained by superposing two waves originating from two narrow slits. Okay. The diffraction pattern, what is diffraction pattern? It is a superposition of continuous family of waves. Diffraction pattern is superposition of continuous family of waves originating from each point on single slit. Originating from each point on a single slit.
Continuous
family of waves. Originating from each point on a single slit. Thank you. find out. Third point, for a single slit of width A, the first minima happens at an angle of lambda by A. What is angle? Y divided by D. This is your tan theta, right? Is tan theta, and since angle is very small, that is theta also. Fine. So the first minima in single slit happens at an angle of lambda by A. Okay. At the same angle, you get maxima in double slit experiment, where the slits are separated by distance A. Getting it? For double slit, at the same angle where A is distance between the slit, you get maxima.